Situated in the retroperitoneal, an adrenal gland is sitting on the top of it. Its vertebral level is around T12 to L3, and the size is around 12 by 6 by 4 centimeter, weighing 150 gram in males and 135 grams in females, and surrounded by the renal capsule, which is again followed by the perinephric fat, and followed by the gerota fascia, and finally the paranephric fat on the outside. And the parenchymal kidney is divided into two major parts, is the cortex and medulla. And the kidney is getting a lot of blood supply, getting 20% of cardiac output, as you must be knowing, from the renal arteries. And the lymphatic drainage is around the aortic side, called the para-aortic lymph nodes. And nerve supply is via renal sympathetic, around the T10 to L1 level. You can see here the kidney, the capsule, the perinephric fat, gerota fascia, and the paranephric fat, that the two fat layers. And here you can see here the cortex here and the medulla here. You can see the two layer, the kidney followed by the pelvis here. There are many functions of kidney. The main top function is the waste excretion, followed by the acid base balance, followed by osmolarity control and blood pressure and hormone secretion like erythropoietin. Coming to the renal tumor represents the around 3% of all adult malignancy. Lot of cases, lot of death in the United States. And again, you must be knowing it's divided into benign and malignant tumor. There are many benign tumors which can happen in the kidney. But oncocytoma and angiomyolipoma, these are two common tumors. But the kidney can be side of the adenoma, leiomyoma, lipoma, fibroma, rhabdomyoma, neurofibroma, and hemangioma. So two important tumors are oncocytoma. Again, the oncocytoma represent around 3 to 7% of tumor, common in male, and it got the association with the renal cell carcinoma. And 10 color tumor, size around 4 to 6 centimeter, usually unifocal. In contrary, the other tumor, which is the angiomyolipoma, is multifocal. And the 83% present with the pain, with a is incidental finding, present as a pain or hematuria. CT scan with contrast is the most important investigation. Sometimes very difficult to differentiate between RCC and the oncocytoma. And the treatment is a partial nephrectomy, but the radiofrequency ablation and HIFU can be the another option if the patient is unfit. You can see here, this is the tumor here, you can see, and here lie the cut section. Another unusual tumor is angiomyolipoma. It composed of three parts, as I mentioned here, angio, myo, and lipoma. So it have got is composed of the blood vessels, the smooth muscle cells, and the fat cells. Fat cells are very important in this tumor, which makes its appearance as a black on the plain X-ray. And it is common in females and associated with tuberous sclerosis, and usually present as incidental tumor. But can present a flank mass, hematuria, and sometimes it can associate with the massive retroperitoneal bleeding, need urgent intervention. Usually it is small in size, less than 4 cm in size, and diagnosed on ultrasound, but it can be larger tumor, which would require, the tumor size is more than 4 cm, that require embolization or some kind of conservative surgery. And we have to do possibly a conservative surgery because it can be bilateral and it can be multiple, like in tuberous sclerosis. Here you can see the tumor, very, very well outlined here. Then the coming to malignant tumor, the pediatric age group tumor are the Wilms tumor or nephroblastoma, where the adult tumor can be of three kinds. One is the renal cell carcinoma, which also called as adenocarcinoma or hypernephroma. and then the TCC, renal pelvis, and squamous cell carcinoma again arising from the renal pelvis. First of all, the pediatric tumor is a Wilms tumor, which was named after the Mr. Max Williams, Max Wilms, who first diagnosed it. And it is one of the childhood tumor, as I said earlier, and this usually affects that children less than 15 years of age, and 10% are familial, and 5% are bilateral, and 75% present below 5 years of age. This occurs due to deletion, mutation at the WT1 genes on chromosome number 11 to 13. Mostly present as the hematuria, but it can present like big abdominal mass or pain. Diagnosed on the ultrasound, but CT scan can be more diagnostic. You can see here, it can usually present like a big bulge, huge tumor. One of the cut section, treatment is a nephrectomy, but better option is the neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Tumor is big, followed by surgery and followed by chemotherapy. Surprisingly, the tumor, childhood tumor, are more chemosensitive in contrast to adulthood, which is chemoresistant. So coming back to the renal cell carcinoma, this is the adenocarcinoma of the renal cortex arising from proximal convertibule. One of the most common renal tumor and represent the 2-3% of all adult cancer. Common is more common in the sixth decade of life, and the more common in males with a ratio of 2:1. And this is one of the 10th most common case of the cancer death. Different risk factor has been defined. The tobacco, it really accounts for the lot of 30% of RCC. Environmental people, cadmium, thorium, petroleum, and phenacetin energy. Leather tanners, shoe workers, asbestos worker, they are more prone. Obesity is a risk factor. Hypertension is another risk factor for the RCC. And the people on the long-term dialysis, they are again one of the risk factor for the RCC. And polycystic disease is again one of the risk factor for developing the RCC. And the one of the other risk factor is the von Hippel-Lindau syndrome, VHL syndrome. You can see here different type of the RCCs, renal cell carcinoma. Most common is clear cells, followed by papillary, chromophobes. These are the another tumor, but another tumor we call the collecting duct tumors or sarcomas. Discuss again. One of the most common tumor is the clear cell carcinoma. Okay. Clinically, there are different the triad of hematuria, flank pain, and palpable mass. But classical triad is seldom seen, and usually diagnosed incidentally in the ultrasound finding. But sometimes it can present like hematuria or flank pain. These are the two common things. Probably the flank. Palpable mass is a rare finding, but you can have, the most common is hematuria or the flank pain. But there are systemic manifestation, anemia, fatigue, weight loss, cachexia, hypercalcemia, and hepatic dysfunction. And there are paraneoplastic syndrome, the parathyroid, this is because of the production of the PTH-like hormones, or erythropoietin, renin, gonadotropin, placental lactogen, prolactin, the interglucagone, insulin-like hormone, the ACTH-like hormones, and the prostaglandins. Natural history, as I said earlier, diagnosed incidentally as incidentinoma, 45% present localized disease, renal invasion seen in 21%, IVC involvement 4%, and distinct metastasis can be one of the presentation in which lungs, bones, liver, skin, and the CNS are the common site. To diagnose the, you should start with a complete CP. That may show anemia or polycythemia, depending upon the which factor is going more. The erythropoietin factor or the blood loss. Renal function, LFT, urine analysis to see the microscopic hematuria, ultrasound KUB to see the renal mass, and CT abdomen to see the extension of the mass and size of the mass. You can see here, this is one of the big mass here. You can see big mass over here. This is a normal kidney. This is a big mass in what is the part of the kidney. To check metastasis, we can have this the X-ray chest or CT chest. And usually we do the CT scan of abdomen and pelvis and bone scan if the ALP is high or the history of bone pain. This is one of the TNM classification you can see here. First of all, it start like that. T1 is tumor is less than 7 cm is T1. T2 is tumor more than 7 cm but confined to kidney. T3 tumor going outside the kidney. It involves the veins, adenals or perinephric tissue. Again, T4 means the beyond gerotofacia. Again, coming back to T1A is less than 4 cm. T1B is between 4 to 7 cm in size. And T2 is more than 7 cm but confined to kidney. T3 is the one which is coming outside the kidney. If it is involved the adrenal veins, perinephric tissue, then this is called T3A. T3B is going into the renal vein or IVC, and T3C is going into IVC above the diaphragm or invade the wall of the IVC. And while the T4 is, as I said earlier, is invaded beyond the gerotofacia. And regarding nodal status, N1 is a tumor which involves a single regional lymph node, while N2 is involved the more than one regional lymph nodes. And no metastasis, M1 is a distinct metastasis. Again, the staging, you can very well appreciate the T1 is stage 1, T2 is stage 2, T3 is stage 3, but without lymph node or the metastasis. If any T1 or T2, if it is associated with a nodal involvement, they become stage 3 disease. While a stage 4 disease is, as I said earlier, T4 alone itself is a stage 4 disease. T4 with N1 is again, this is the stage 4 disease. And any T with N2 or M1 is supposed to be the stage 4 disease. This is the diagrammatic representation here. You can see tumor within the kidney is T1, stage 1. Invasion is stage 2, and this is going in the regional lymph nodes or IVC stage 3, and adjacent organ involvement is stage 4. The 5-year survival depend on the different factor in which the pathological staging, tumor size and histological types are very important. As I said earlier, the T1, T2 have got the around 70-90% 5-year survival rate. While this is going to be decreased, if it is T3, then again the 50-70%, and further going down if it is the M1. Tumor size, if it is less than 4 centimeters, then the 90% 5-year survival rate. Between 4 to 10 is 50%. If it is more than 10 centimeters, there's 0% 5-year survival rate. So this thing is very important. This, although clear cell carcinoma is the most common tumor, around 75% tumor, but it have got a survival rate not very good as compared to papillary and chromophobes. And the best survival rate can be seen in multilocular cystic lesion, 100% chances to become the 5-year survival rate. While medullary tumor and Kallikak duct tumor is one of the worst tumor, they got 0% 5-year survival rate. So next thing is the treatment. Radical nephrectomy is the gold standard for the localized RCC, and the principle is the perifacial removal of gland. That means you take out the gerotofacia along with the kidney. That's very important. That's called perifacial. And so we have to ligate the vessels early, and we have to remove ciliated gland, especially tumor is confined to the upper part. Regional adenectomy, lympharenectomy. Please remember, This is no more indicative from crest of diaphragm to aortic bifurcation, but all the lymph nodes which are available around the kidney should be taken out. So these are the various stages, the position of the patient, the dissection and refinery ligation of the vessels. And here we divide the vessel first, and we take our tumor. Nephron sparing surgery is another option. That means we preserve the kidney, we do not take out the whole kidney. And it's indicated when there is a bilateral RCC in a solitary function kidney, unilateral RCC with the contralateral kidney, which is not likely to be good in the future, like with the patient with renal artery stenosis, pyelonephritis, hydronephrosis, reflux disease, calculus disease, and patient with diabetes. Or the tumor is less than 4 cm with the normal opposite kidney. If you take care, then the 5-year survival rate can be 75% to 85%, but the definite risk of the local tumor recurrence of 10%. You can see here, this is the tumor. You can take it out with the margins and repair this kidney like that. This similar thing can be done at the upper pole or the lower pole, is small tumors. This is the mid-pole tumor. For disease which has been metastasized, you can do surgery, radiotherapy, chemotherapy, targeted therapy, and immunotherapy. We'll discuss one after the other. Surgery, we can perform palliative nephrectomy in the patient who had severe hemorrhage, pain, patient with a paraneoplastic syndrome, patient with adjacent visceral compression, solitary metastasis. You can take out the tumor and take out the metastasis also. This is called palliative nephrectomy. When this is performed for palliation, there is a nephrectomy called therapeutic nephrectomy. This is simply performed when these symptoms are not there, but there is metastasis. In that case, you have to take out the kidney so that the 5-year disease-free survival rate can be increased. It's not curative, but it will simply increase the chance of survival. There is a separate thing called metastasectomy. That means we take out to remove the metastasis separately. This can be done in the liver and lung metastasis. The solitary metastasis, like in liver, the left lobe is involved. You can take out the left lobectomy. Or in the lungs, if it is solitary metastasis, like in one of the lobe of the lung, you can take out that lobe, and then along with the nephrectomy, and it have showed better result. The terminology called spontaneous regression of the metastasis. This can happen in only less than 1% of patient, and probably said the body immunity take over when you remove the primary tumor. Radiotherapy is only indicated in the bone metastasis, solitary bone metastasis, or in the brain metastasis. Basically, this tumor is a radio resistant, as you know, but in these two indications, solitary bone metastasis and brain metastasis, this can be done with a higher dosage. Because this is a radio resistant tumor, you have to use it higher dose. Some people do respond with that thing, but overall radiation is not good. Chemotherapy, this is again a tumor which is not chemosensitive, rather chemo-resistant, and people start with 5-fluorouracil, then trials are going on with the gemcitabine along with the 5-FU, but results are not good. People have tried the cisplatin, cariplatin, in non-clear cell RCC, but still results are not good. There are some results which can be seen in the targeted molecular therapy. This is a new type of the treatment, and there are three groups in it: tyrosine kinase inhibitor, monoclonal antibodies, and mammalian target of rapamycin. Basic philosophy of using this drug to stop the new vascularization, because as you know, the renal cell carcinoma is notorious by virtue of the producing factor which can promote the new vascularity and rapidly spread a tumor. So the idea to use this medicine, which is called targeted molecular therapy, is to decrease the new vascularization, so decrease the tumor size. But it hardly increases survival in month. 8 to 9 months survival is increased. On the other hand, these drugs are very costly. तो यू सिंपली बट यू शुड नो द वेरियस ग्रुप्स ऑफ दिस ड्रग. फर्स्ट ग्रुप इज टायरोसिन काइनेज इनहिबिटर एंड देयर आर टू ड्रग्स सुरिनटिन एंड दिस सोराफिनिब. रिगार्डिंग द मोनोक्लोनल एंटीबॉडीज दे आर दिस आर द बेवसिजुमैब एंड द रिगार्डिंग मेमेलियन टारगेट ऑफ रैपामाइसिन दिस कॉल्ड एमटोर इनहिबिटर द टिमसोलिमस. Immunotherapy is a kind of the treatment which can be only effective in a patient with a good performance status who has a nephrectomy and is non-bulky tumor or only soft tissue metastasis and asymptomatic patient. Interferon interleukin 2 has been tried, but they require in very high dose, and the toxicity of these drugs itself is a potential factor which is not good for the patient. So in summary, RCC is a rare tumor and it is associated with tobacco and many inherited disorder like VHL syndrome. Surgery is the only treatment option in the patient with stage 1, 2 and 3. Radioresistant tumor very work like palliation only. Stage 4 disease have got the bad prognosis, but you can try the new drugs like sorafenib, sunitinib and temsirolimus. These are the approved drug, but they can hardly increase the survival in month. So this is all about it. Thank you very much.